So in the previous discussion, I have talked about Clytemnestra and Electra's interaction with each other. I just want to add a few more points to that by analyzing a few comments from Electra's speech. And there are actually two things I want to discuss here. First is the way Electra has been portrayed in the play. She is absolutely obsessed with one thing, that is her father's revenge. And due to this excessive mourning and her determination to follow any course of action that somehow helps her succeed in her intentions of exacting revenge on Clytemnestra and Aegisthus. And this is why Chrysothemis calls her unreasonable. But in this speech, we find some ideas and comments by Electra very striking and insightful. For instance, at one point, she very intelligently warns Clytemnestra about the vicious cycle of murder and revenge murder that has inflicted this family of Atreus for generations. And the way Clytemnestra justifies her act of murdering Agamemnon, calling it a revenge murder done to give justice to innocent and unfairly, unduly killed Iphigenia. She says, but even if, let's say, we grant your claim, he did these things to help his brother, was it right he should die for it at your hands? By what law? Watch out, this particular law could recoil upon your own head. If we made it a rule to answer killing with killing, you would die first in all justice. See, this is very ironical. She reminds Clytemnestra about the weak grounds on which she justifies her act of murder. But at the same time, the irony is, despite knowing that killing with killing will ultimately lead to innumerable deaths, she still wants Clytemnestra and Aegisthus to be murdered in revenge for Agamemnon's murder. So it shows her own inability to consider that the same passion of revenge that Electra embodies negates her own insightful comment. The comment in itself is very wisely made, but practically Electra herself is acting against this insight and wisdom. This is where Sophocles, the playwright, actually signifies, shows how mourning, lamentation clouds her judgment. She is unable to see the error of her ways. Secondly, and this is again very important, if we look at Clytemnestra's treatment of Chrysothemis and Electra, the two daughters who are still alive with her, although Orestes is still alive, but he is living in a distant city. And we notice that Clytemnestra does not deal affectionately with her daughters. Instead, she has allowed Aegisthus to exercise suffocating and oppressive rule over these daughters of hers. Although she is portrayed as an unusually powerful and dominant female character in the play, but Aegisthus is the one to whom she succumbs. So the point I just want to make here is Clytemnestra's unfair treatment of Chrysothemis and Electra implies that the prime excuse that she mentions for justification of Agamemnon's murder, love of a mother for her daughter or a child, sounds very superficial and false. Because if she had so much love for Iphigenia to kill her husband, why would she allow Aegisthus to make the life of her living daughters miserable? So her unfair treatment of Electra and Chrysothemis signifies that her love for her children is not that strong as she portrays. And this becomes even more obvious when the news of Orestes' death is conveyed to her. We find her slightly shocked, and she expresses her pain over receiving this news, but she is not genuinely aggrieved. In the very next moment, she is willing to offer an award to the messenger who brings the news of Orestes' death. So we'll talk about this episode later. For the time being, what you need to understand is this unmotherly treatment of her children by Clytemnestra further strengthens Electra's rejection of the prime motive of Agamemnon's murder given by Clytemnestra herself, that she killed him because he killed her innocent daughter. So we can say that here, as readers, we feel that probably Electra's argument is stronger than Clytemnestra. And next, if we analyze the exchange of dialogues between Electra and Clytemnestra, there are a few things which you must note down and understand. All this discussion between the two is actually a debate on the moral status of Clytemnestra's act. Clytemnestra finds herself justified on moral grounds, claiming that it was a killing in response to killing. So she justifies herself on moral grounds, claiming that this was a revenge murder. Murder in response to murder. At the same time, we notice that the language both of these characters use is accusatory and rude. We find both of these characters adamant and very stubborn to maintain and uphold and support their own viewpoint. They do not try to see the validity or logical power that might be present in the other person's argument. So both of them try to justify themselves, claiming that they are actually seeking justice. Their cause is fair and legal. But significantly, in the first play, Agamemnon by Aeschylus, we find Clytemnestra very dominant in terms of her demeanor and even in terms of her power of words. But here, Electra dominates Clytemnestra through sheer force of her conviction and personality. She shows unusual and exceptional, untraditional vigor and power to carry on with the same passion and asking for the murder of these two killers, despite having spent so many years. She has not relented. She is still very firm in her conviction, in her determination. And this is why Clytemnestra, who otherwise appears unchallenged and unaffected by anybody else, finds herself threatened. So this thing is evident from Chrysothemis' revelation of a secret plan which is made by Clytemnestra and Aegisthus to imprison Electra in a cave because they are afraid of what she might possibly be able to do. So this is it on the interaction between mother and daughter. We'll continue with this play in our upcoming discussions. Thank you.